So our why, how sessions, and that's what we're doing today, is structured, and it has a kind of why, how from facilitators, and then an activity, a seedling, one of the good tree puns, and then a share out. So it's a little bit more of a structured kind of idea. And this is the first time we're trying it, so you can let us know how you think it went at the end. So our topic is building a culture of care and respect in our online classes. And I know that's something that everybody does in a lot of different ways all at once. Like, there's lots of little things. And so when Peg and I were talking about it, we were talking about just a few things we could isolate from our own courses about how we think we do this. And then of course, we're looking forward to hearing how everybody else does it too. Peg is mostly gonna handle the why part, and then I'll go on and present some of the how part. So I think Peg, I can turn it over to you, and the why, build a culture of respect and community.
Yeah. So this is a topic that is really important to me. And after talking to Cara, it was, you know, something really important to her as well. Just because I personally learn with a teacher who's kind and nice to me, and just thinking and reflecting back on my own educational experience and thinking about the teachers who, and even not just teachers, but fellow classmates. Like, when I was in a space where I did not feel comfortable, I now reflect back and I'm like, no wonder why I did poorly in that class, or no wonder why I poorly, you know, I had a poor experience in that setting. So that's why, like, I think this topic is really important to us. And I thought that it would be good to do like a similar reflection for all of us that I did, because so we often don't get time to reflect so much. But I told Cara, like, why don't we start with like a 3-minute activity in which we go to this Padlet and type without worrying about grammar or punctuation or sounding smart. Like, I just want you guys to like reflect on like why you came into not just the teaching world, but the community college teaching world. You know, what was your drive and why do you keep doing it today? So if you don't mind, go and click on this Padlet link. And I will also put the link directly in the chat too. And just for 3 minutes, I'll put on some nice music. And I would like everyone just to type in, why are you here in the community college teaching world?
Your skincare routine sucks.
Do I need to have an account to sign in? I see the pad, but I can't write on it.
You should be able to just hit the plus sign, Espen, or you can double click on the Padlet.
Yeah, it should work. I don't have an account and it's working for me.
Okay.
Sorry, I was trying to get the music, but it's like making me nervous. So forget the music.
Ega, just sing for us.
I might make you want to leave the Zoom if I sing.
Never.
I'm not sure if Peg is talking to us, but I can't hear her.
Oh, sorry. Thank you, Espen. Thank you. I forgot I was muted. I was just saying that we'll go back to the Padlet and reflect a little bit more. So keep in mind what you wrote in the Padlet. But I wanted us to just watch 5 minutes of Michelle Pekinski-Brock's presentation. She presented this during Flex Week, during the Catalyst Conference, if you all remember. But I really, this part of her presentation really resonated with me because it's not just like people preaching and telling faculty or even fellow classmates in the classroom to be kind. It's actually the science that is proving how the learning brain works. So I really wanted us just to kind of watch 5 minutes of Michelle's presentation. I have the link to the full presentation here, and then specifically her slides 3 to 9 as well. But we'll just watch 5 minutes of it just for the purpose of time.
When a person continuously is expected to just fit in, it's dehumanizing and it's absolutely exhausting. And this presentation is going to help you see barriers that may exist within some of your courses or other aspects of your campus. I realize we have folks here who are not teachers, but in other roles. So we want to kind of extend this outside of the classroom also and think about how some of these barriers are leaving some students out.
Peggy, we're seeing the YouTube cool icon banner.
So before we get any further, it's important.
Sorry, I don't know what's going on with my technology. Okay, I'm going to try it one more time. If it doesn't work, I'll just put the YouTube in the chat, and then I'll have you guys watch it on your own, but let me try it one more time.
Of your campus. I realize we have folks here who are not teachers, but in other roles. So we want to kind of extend this outside of the classroom also and think about how some of these barriers are leaving some students out. So before we get any further, it's important to realize that we're talking about changes in our brain, that experience of not belonging. It triggers dramatic changes inside of the human brain. In your brain, your limbic system handles emotions and the cortex in your brain handles reason. Now, usually these two parts of the brain work cooperatively together. They're kind of going back and forth, negotiating what's happening in your world around you. During exposure to stress, the amygdala, which is part of the limbic system, sends signals to other parts of your brain to release stress hormones. This is referred to as an amygdala takeover, if you've ever heard that phrase. When that happens, a person begins to experience physical changes, sweaty hands and neck, faster heartbeat and breathing, right? All those things that I described when I was walking into my reunion. That is your body's natural reaction to a stressful situation. It's preparing your body to either defend itself or run away. This goes back to our basic human reactions. And we know this process as fight or flight, right? It's the same type of reaction that allows us to stay safe in the face of danger. And our body goes through the same changes in moments of stress, and all kinds of things trigger stress and all kinds of things trigger not belonging. And I recognize my positionality in this conversation about belonging. And this is something I did think about that night at my reunion. You know, my privileges that I have, my white skin, my abled body, my cisgender, all of these things that give me kind of power in a social environment. And I thought about my classmates, and I think about my students, our students who don't have access to those privileges. So these are things that I reflect on very deeply. Racism is something that very much triggers these changes inside of a person. The point here is that emotions are so powerful. Emotions have the ability to derail our thought processes and take control of our actions. Yet in a college classroom, sometimes, depending on the way you teach, I realize we're all different, and some of you are gonna say, not me, but in college classes, it can be the norm to expect students to check their emotions at the door. And it can be the norm for you as a college educator to not show emotions. White dominant culture is not a culture that embraces messy, sticky emotions, the squishy stuff, right? That's an influence of, if you're feeling that way, if you identify with that, it's really important to recognize that that's an influence of our white dominant culture. But folks, we are educators, and our focus, if you're in a teaching role, is on teaching and learning. If we disregard the role of emotions and learning, we're leaving out many of our students. Now, leading neuroscientists Mary Helen Imordino Yang and Antonio Damasio have written, emotions are not just messy toddlers in a china shop running around breaking and obscuring delicate cognitive glassware. Instead, they are more like the shelves underlying the glassware. Without them, cognition has less support. That quote, when I heard it, was very powerful. And so it has become something that I like to share. It's one that's visual. And I find that when you have visual analogies, they really tend to stick with a person more. So I hope that sticks with you.
So without them, cognition has less support. And just for the purpose of time, I don't want to show much more of the video, but this portion of Michelle's presentation really stood with me. And if you continue watching the rest of her talk, you'll see how, like, under stress or emotion or, you know, trauma, the student is not even learning. So they're sitting in our Zoom classes, and they're just listening to you talk, and it's just going in from one ear out the other. And ultimately, they don't really perform well. So I wanted us to go back to the Padlet, but this time I want you to take a look at a syllabi from your class. Take a look at your assignment sheet, maybe a test or exam or a quiz. Maybe you can take a look at your Canvas, take a look at one of your slides for your lectures, or maybe take a look at a class activity and go back to the Padlet and go and reply to your original comment. And I want you to type some examples of classroom practices or languages that connect back to your why. And I just want us to kind of learn from each other what kind of language we use, what kind of activities we create that brings us to why we're here in the business of community college teaching. I love how the Padlet is said to be anonymous. So we're here for the money. Oh, I like the one that says, I don't assume prior content knowledge. I also don't assume that students know how to learn in a college style course. I love that. It's like checking your assumptions at the door. Supportive, encouraging, and engagement-focused learning activities. I try to foster an open learning environment where everyone feels heard and included. Pulsing students to see how we can better support them. So important to check in with them. I love that one. I do think I'm meeting this why. With my course materials, they are student-centered through and through. I love that. Putting the students at the heart of everything. Even if it's like creating a syllabi, even if it's creating an assignment sheet. Our students' unique stories make our classes that much richer. Yeah, bringing their stories into the forefront, so important. They feel empowered too. When you ask them to tell you about themselves, they love that. I know that because I'm an English teacher. Ooh, that's fun. I have students introduce themselves by telling what they like to do, then group them. And they have to figure out how. That's so cool. Kind of creating a community. That's awesome. I'm glad that we got a chance to sit in this Padlet space together to just kind of remind ourselves like why we're here. Sometimes we get so caught up in the daily grind of Zooms and meetings, we forget why we're here. And I'm glad that you got a chance to connect some of your daily routine and your activities to your why. So with that said, I'm going to go to the next slide and have Kara share a little bit about the how, like how can we continue to do this work and support our students?
Thank you, Pega. And thanks everyone for that Padlet. I don't usually use Padlet, so it was also just fun to kind of experience it in real time in that way. Okay, so we've got some why now. And how is the next part? So there keeps being a funny shape that jumps up in front, Pega.
Okay. Oh.
Okay. So cultivating community and a culture of respect in the classroom is not an exact science, of course, and we all do it differently. And I think we all do it in a lot of little ways at once. When I asked about that in the Pronto thread yesterday, people were weighing in, some with assignments and like big ideas, and others just with small things they do, like how they address their students and things like that. So I think we all know this already, that it's like a full court press, right, to create and cultivate that community. But I thought I would share a couple of things that I think help and that I've been trying to do. The first one, and would you mind advancing? Mm-hmm. Is about Zoom. So last semester I was all asynchronous. Now I'm teaching a synchronous class. So I was kind of like coming back to thinking about Zoom and how to do kind of community building and create respect on Zoom, which feels hard. And it feels hard to do without just piling on rules because you kind of need the rules, right? But just like listing rules makes people feel dehumanized. Me too. If I go someplace and people tell me a lot of rules, I feel resentful right away. So I've been trying to kind of find that balance. Would you go to the next slide?
Mm-hmm.
So some of it is covered up. I wonder, Pega, do you mind if I share mine instead?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
For whatever reason, it's getting blacked on yours.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Sorry, got it. Too many tabs open as usual. Okay. Are you all seeing it now, the full screen?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. So anyway, I want to make sure you saw all these dogs because they're cute. Here they are. But the thing that I wanted to get to about like something that can help maybe with synchronous classes when it comes to trying to create a sense of community, but not just pile on rules. I've been trying to do that. I just made a video that I share with my class. It is not perfect, and I think I'm going to redo it at some point, but my aim in the video was to like go through the rules, but without it feeling alienating, and in that kind of set a tone for a real community environment on Zoom. So I was going to have you watch it, but not the whole thing. You can start it around like minute 255 because the beginning's just intro. And I recommend watching it on 1.5 speed because I talk too slow in it. So if you didn't know this, when you have a Canvas Studio video or a YouTube video, there's a place where you can up the speed, and putting it to 1.5 minutes is like a wonderful thing, in my opinion. Cuts out all the ums and stuff. So, or at least gives them less time. So I'm going to ask you to just take a second, mute yourself so people don't all hear it, and listen to and watch this video starting from around that minute. And then when we come back, I'm going to ask you these questions. So what elements in that video might help set the tone for respect and community that could carry into the classroom? And then what would you actually change about that or add to help, you know, set that positive tone and sense of community in your own classes? So let me go ahead and share that. Okay, so I just shared the video link. So go ahead and take like 3 minutes to watch that starting around minute 255.
Don't let technical problems make you miserable. They're definitely going to happen. We'll work through them together.
How are we doing on time? Was that enough time to look at that? Yeah, thumbs ups and nods. Cool. Thank you. I forgot to look at the minute when we started. So like I said, that is absolutely not like the perfect thing, but I think it can help us to talk about how we might change something like that or make our own, or how I could adjust even to make it more community building. So do you all have any thoughts on that? You're welcome to raise a hand, because then you'll pop to the top and I'll see you, or you can share in the chat. My questions about it are, what elements do you think might help set the tone of respect and community building that could carry into class meetings? And then what might you add or change in your own to meet that goal more? Yeah, Liz.
I loved what I heard so far. And I really liked how you mentioned, I think we can do this in the class, saying we instead of you really brings everyone together, makes it feel like a sense of community. And also like you're one of the, you know, you're right there with the students. And then I also like how you just kind of share out how they should, you know, respect with each other and how they should talk and engage, giving these tips and tricks for students that maybe are newer or brand new to using Zoom. And not really understanding, you know, the best etiquette where they can have a good engaging environment. I think that really is helpful to kind of give that information and put it out there really clearly stated. So I think everything that you shared really set the tone for a good community class.
Thank you. So far that class has been a good community, but I do think there is always ways that we can be like even more deliberate about it. Does anyone have any suggestions for things that they would add or change in their own to make it even more community oriented? Or anyone else have any other comments in general? There we go.
I liked that you, oh, I just got to share this. Okay, it was another comment in general, but I liked the, how you like kind of talked about privacy and not sharing the videos without getting really technical about it, just being like, this is why they don't, we're not going to post it on YouTube, this is why you shouldn't share it, and versus like, let me tell you about FERPA. If anyway, just like very approachable way to be like, this is how we're doing it.
Yeah. Thank you for noticing that. I feel like that is something that I have to work on, because we're all so acronymy, you know, like, and so I have to be like, wait, do I even know what that acronym means? And can I say it like not in that way? So that was a conscious choice. Since students never, you know those things, why would they? Yeah, thank you for that, Rachel. And yeah, Tamina.
Just a quick comment, Cara. I think I'm taking another equity class right now. And I think I learned that we should say it. You kind of touched it this way, but I think it's, it may be, if I had done this video, I would have done it this way, that to make it clear that I realize that you may not, you mentioned spotty places, but I do realize that you don't have to turn on your video at all, even though I like to see you. But I respect that, you know, you may have issues with Wi-Fi, you may have not, you know, enough, gigabytes or whatever they call that. So realize that, but because once they open up the video, it takes up more data. And so I do realize, so I would add one sentence just like that.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's key too, to recognize that it's a technical issue a lot of the time, because people will think like, oh, you know, they're not engaged or their house is chaotic or something, which is also a good reason, like the chaotic house, but sometimes it really is just that technical. Yeah, I have that at the very beginning of the video, but I think that that's definitely good to point to. And I mean, I have to turn off my camera a lot during Zoom sessions because my Zoom gets spotty too. So I almost like, I want students to be able to extend that courtesy to their teachers too, of not making assumptions if we can't have our camera on. Yeah, yeah, thank you.
And many of our students are attending classes from their closet or cars.
Yeah.
So we just have to respect that, because of equity issues, you know, we just have to be more sensitive. So the tone, you've covered it, but I would have maybe used a different sentence.
Yeah, that's good feedback. Yeah, it's crazy the way people are in such difficult situations. I had a student who was going from her bathroom the other day, and she private chatted me to be like, I'm not going to turn the camera on. I don't require cameras, but she told me anyway, because she was like, oh, I'm in my bathroom because that's the only space, which is like, I mean, thank goodness she has a space, but that is a lot to be doing your class in the bathroom.
And one thing, Cara, I just did it because I teach at Moreno Valley College also. So Tuesday was the first day. So at the very beginning, I did a poll question that where would they connect from? So I think that's another, you know, we can, in our orientation, we can just do a simple survey. Or I did it with poll questions day one, just to get an idea, who is my audience? How often do they want to join? You know, just basic things like that.
Agreed. So in a minute, we'll have like kind of some time to work on an activity. And one of the potential activities would be building something like that video. So I know you can't make a video in like the 15 minutes that we have to work, but if you don't already have some kind of a Zoom guidelines video and you're teaching synchronously, that would be a great use of some of our teaching tree time, is to figure out, well, what would I put in there? So Tamina just had some great suggestions. You can use some of mine. Hopefully watching mine gave you ideas of like, oh, well, she didn't say this thing. Maybe I can, you know, that's something that's important to me. So you can kind of figure that out. And then probably yours won't come out till 7 minutes. I wanted to make mine shorter. But anyway, that's something to think about, and we'll have some time to work on in a minute. I saw that there were a couple other people with hands up, but I think I'm going to move on just in the interest of time, and then we'll have time at the end, hopefully, to chat about it. So sorry to skip past you. But because we don't all teach synchronously, I wanted to also mention something else that I think can really work well in terms of building community. And this is something that's good for synchronous and asynchronous classes. So an occasional community building discussion board that's tied to your course material, but something that's really about students helping each other succeed, I think that can go a really long way. And I've seen that in my classes, how if students can answer each other's questions and it's a formalized system where they're being asked by me to like go in there and help each other, and you know, they get credit for it. Just having them go through that seems to really create a community where they then help each other on Pronto, or they help each other in Zoom study sessions or whatever. So formalizing the thing of students helping each other online seems to be something that works well, at least in my courses. And I've heard that from other teachers too. So a well-designed community building discussion board, it can remind students that they're all humans. You know, it's so easy to see each other as bots on Zoom or in an asynchronous class in particular. So if they're in there answering each other's questions and helping each other, it just helps them remember that they're in an actual classroom, even if they can't see faces. And I think their input and responses, when it can help their peers succeed and help them in turn get support, it does just kind of like reinforce why community is important. Because there can be this feeling in asynchronous classes, like I can do this myself, I don't actually need anybody. And that can sometimes be true, but it's not as good an experience for students. So if they can be reminded that there's real satisfaction and learning that comes from that exchange, then that I think can really help them from just like barreling through the asynchronous class by themselves. So there's lots of different ways to do this, but I had one example that was pretty general that I made. And I've got a link for it right here. So if you are interested in just seeing an example, I put this in a Google Doc, and you're welcome, if you like it, to make a copy of the Google Doc and just like use these instructions and personalize them for your class. But it's just a general kind of discussion board that I use a version of to get students to ask questions of their peers and then answer each other's questions. And again, just every so often, it seems to help. Another great way to potentially create community using asynchronous methods was something that one of our wonderful colleagues shared. So I'm gonna let Pega speak to that. You're muted, Pega.
Sorry. Professor Romali Rodrigo in the English department does this great acknowledgement Padlet at the very start of the semester. Instead of doing the discussion thread on Canvas, I personally like the discussion thread, but I know she likes the acknowledgement Padlet. And basically, the assignment or the prompt she asks the students to respond to is, Cara, would you let me share the screen? This is the acknowledgement or gratitude page. And she says to her students, the link below will take you to a Padlet. And then she explains Padlet a little bit. And she says, use the link below to go to Padlet and add to our community acknowledgements or gratitude page. Before we start anything big, it is often helpful to frame it by contextualizing it, acknowledging or being grateful for the things, people, and places that have led us to this moment can help us better plan and engage in the journey we're about to begin. And then she gives a recording of herself adding, you know, some ideas, but just to have the students begin the course at the very start of the semester and showing them that this is a space in which we are going to be open and vulnerable about our emotions sets the tone for the remainder of the classroom. She tells them to be thoughtful and free to truly express gratitude to whoever or whatever you're thinking about when you consider what led you here today. And then she gives them some assignment instructions. And then I just want to briefly show you some of the responses, some of the deep responses that her students, you know, have generated. And it's just like a really beautiful way of, you know, not only building community, but also showing students that you can, you know, you can be, you know, kind and learn and not really, you know, worry about people judging you as you're doing so. So these are some of the responses that her students have shared. And Romali took the names of the students off for privacy. So these are just some screenshots. Like the first student wrote, I would like to acknowledge this generation. Depending on your perspective, the recent years have been dynamic for some and chaotic for others. Nevertheless, the generation that we are all a part of is filled with innovative and brilliant minds. We question everything, and that mentality has led us all on a journey of self-awareness, healing, and solution-oriented practices. We are breaking generational habits and improving our mental, physical, and spiritual well-being. What a time to be alive. So that's showing that the stuff that's going on in society is really affecting our students. And this is a great way for them to practice putting their emotions into words and actually letting it out rather than just suppressing it. I'll read another student comment that really stood out to me. The student wrote, California is by far the most important source of fruits, vegetables, nuts, dairy, meat, and other products of the US food system. California growers employ 1 out of 3 of the nation's farm workers. Some 70% of these workers were born in Mexico. I want to acknowledge the worn hands and backs of the men and women that feed America, many of them here illegally. As a child of an immigrant and as a first generation immigrant in this country, I want to bring attention to the stigma of migrants and their value to a modern society. And it just kind of goes to show like who is in our classroom, like who are our students? They're first generation immigrants in this country. And if they're able to own that identity and their values around their identity, then they will set the tone for the learning of the, for the learning classroom, even if it's on Zoom or on Canvas, we can still make these deep connections with one another. I would love to share more, but I know we're limited in time. So Cara, you want to take the next?
Yes. So I think that I'm going to make a little adjustment to our timing here. So we were going to have you work on an activity during the Zoom, but I think we would be considering how behind we got, I think it would be a better use of our time to just like present this as something you could do later. And then we could just have some time to hear your ideas. So the seedling assignment idea is that you would either create a plan and slides for your video for students that would be some kind of like a community building, tone setting, set up for your Zoom sessions, something like a better version of that video I shared. And then another option would be to create a community building discussion assignment using the thing that I shared in the Google Doc as a model if you want, which is just for like a Canvas discussion or using Ron Molly's project as a discussion. So later on, if you can get some time to work on that and then use this bit.ly, bit.ly/shareout with three T's, that's another Padlet where you can share whatever it is you're working on this topic. So we can kind of like all check back to that asynchronously later on, maybe in a future Teaching Tree Open Lab, we can pop back in and look at it. So in this last 10 minutes then, I wanted to just kind of give some space for us to share ideas. I'm gonna stop sharing so that we can see each other's Zoom squares a little bit better. I know you all do this stuff in your classes, and probably a lot of you are doing it in ways that are similar to what Peg and I presented, and I'm sure there are things we never thought of. So what do y'all have for us? What things do you do to create this sense of community and respect? What has worked? What problems are you having?
So I have kind of a question regarding this. What do you see as the pros, cons to making a video that you post versus going through and creating the Zoom community in the first Zoom session?
That's a good question. I do talk about it in the first Zoom session as well, but I have an orientation model in my courses, orientation module, pardon me, that students need to go through before they start the class. And it's part of the orientation module. So for me, having an orientation module, like before students get on Zoom and they don't know what it's gonna be, I like to have them have all this information. I have three or four videos. One of them is just me going through the syllabus. And then when they come to class, they're already armed with all that. And then they can kind of like know where to come from. Like they're not just like trying to absorb everything. So for me, that pre-preparation is really helpful. Although we do talk about those ideas. I also do, and this is something I would recommend because it's worked out very well for my classes, is I do a syllabus quiz now, or an orientation quiz. So before the semester really gets going, they're watching that video I made, a couple other videos, some basics, a video of me talking through the syllabus. And then they take a really quick little quiz that just makes sure that they understood all that stuff and they can take it as many times as they want. Then by the time we come to that first Zoom session, they already know what the class is. There's not all that anxiety that students come in with about like, what are things gonna be like? So I think that's actually a good thing for building community too. Hopefully that answered your question. Anyone else have a thought on that? Like if you think there's any other benefits about having like that pre-recorded information, even when it's a synchronous class? Okay, looks like no. Yeah, so what other things are people doing in their classes that have worked to create community?
Well, so the reason I brought that up is because I think I'm similar to you, Kara. Like I've taught asynchronously for a long time and then, you know, getting more into synchronous now. I do all the same thing, like an orientation module videos for my asynchronous, but when I've taught synchronous, I've kind of got away from that because I was using the synchronous classroom as that time to build everything. And so one of the things I've been doing, especially in my first week of class, is I do, and actually I learned this from one of the trainings I went through where they kept having us go into breakout rooms for like a minute or two. And I loved it because like, it was just short enough to like kind of chit chat as you don't really know people yet, but not so long that you got stuck there being like, okay, I already introduced myself, you know?
Yeah.
And so I started using that and I think it's worked. And so I did it the first, like, I have two sessions a week with a class and I would use that like almost annoyingly a lot, but you know, cycle through. And so the students got a chance to really meet a lot of people. And I've already found in the second week that they seem to really create this community. And when I do bigger activities now, they know how it works and they know how to do it. But it was like these quick little, I mean, like 2 minute little timer being like, you know, a silly question about astronomy or something, or things that they like or don't like. And I have found that kind of really helped to build the community very quickly.
I love that idea. Cause it's almost like a speed dating. I mean, not dating, but like, you're just really quickly seeing all these different, I'm totally going to try that. That's a great.
I love how you said that. Like, actually in my notes, when I come up with the idea, I actually called it like speed friending or like speed lab group making or something. I never actually said that to them. But that's kind of my idea as well.
Yeah, I really do. I really like that. George, I saw you had your hand up before. And I think I accidentally ignored you.
That's okay. Well, given my discipline, you know, dramatic arts, we're always kind of calling on people to engage in certain activities. So there's lots of opportunities there, and it's folded into the things that I'm supposed to kind of cover in a syllabus. So I'm lucky that way, I guess. One is a breakout rooms. You know, we'll have discussions. We'll have people go to breakout rooms. And one of the assignments is to have people just interview one another, and then they come back, and then I put them on stage. I call it stage, you know, because now you can spotlight people, and then you can add spotlights. So not to make them too nervous, but part of my job is to put them on stage and get a feel for that, to have them tell something about the other person that they just had a conversation with, and maybe three things, and one of those things is a lie. And the rest of the group is supposed to kind of guess what the lie was. That usually happens after some group conversation or some initial breakouts, because they get to know each other a little bit, you know, so there's already some sharing. So then they can say like, oh yeah, I already knew you were in the Navy, you know, so that's not the lie. So they kind of have some time. It takes up time, but it's part of my work. And another thing is a story. So it's like, I got this from some guy online. I forget, I was cruising around, I was an improvisational person. He said, just grab the closest thing next to you on your desk. If it's important to you, all the better. And then you're gonna tell a quick story. And from the first person, like, I am George's paintbrush, and I was used years ago, and then I fell on the floor, and I ended up on the garage, and then his son picked me up and brought him back in and got sick because he licked the end of it or something like that, you know what I mean? So just quickly kind of tell a little story about all the stuff. So they're sharing stuff off their desk or their table. That's a couple of things I've done in the past.
I love that second one. I mean, the two truths and a lie, to be honest, has always stressed me out when people ask me to do that, because I want to like make a really cool lie. But I love the improv one. That just seems like so fun and simple, especially with people being at home, because they're surrounded by their stuff, you know.
It's easy. Yeah. And then they get to choose what they want to present. So it's like, it's the innocuous kind of item, or it's, this is the special thing I created 5 years ago, and then they get to share out a little bit. So it's up to the individual to kind of control the degree with which they share.
That could go asynchronous too. You could make a discussion board where they take a photo of the item and do a quick explanation of it and tell a story either in video or typing in a discussion board. I think that'll work really well. Yeah. Yeah, that's a great one. Tamina.
Very quickly, I learned Google Jamboard from the teaching tree here in November. And then I've been using, so it has been working really well. So I've created a Google Jamboard for each class and different pages, you know, as we go through, I post questions, they respond. So it has been really working well. Students love it. Thank you.
Are you using it in your asynchronous or your synchronous or both?
I'm using in my synchronous.
Cool. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah, with asynchronous, it hasn't worked that well because students don't show up in the office hour the way I was expecting. So I'm struggling now how to make students show up during the office hour and not when I finish the office hour and then I see four different other questions. So students don't show up in the office hour. So I'm struggling with that part a little bit.
Yeah, I'm there with you. It's funny because people are talking about Jamboard so much and I was like, I don't want another tool. But then I had this idea of kind of like the quicker discussions of like, I wanted them to just like share quick things. And I was going to go back to Google Slides or something. Or I realized, wait, I need something that just like they can do like their quick ideas. And I was like, oh, the stupid Jamboards. And you're right. I think they've worked really well for those just like more informal kind of quick shares because they don't allow like a lot of room, you know, for like one page. And I agree. I found that worked really well.
I hear you on the new tools thing though. I'm so resistant to like integrating anything new. I'm like, I have too many, but you're right. Jamboard is really good.
Don't quote me on that. Thanks.
No, it's Katie. True. I'm like, and I'm supposed to be learning all this stuff and I'll just be like, yeah, a little resistant to it. But you know, at least it's still Google, right? Jamboard's still a Google product. So it's still got like similar interface.
Yeah, I did like that. And it's all kind of in your same little area. That was nice.
Espen, did you want to add something?
I just wanted to ask, how many of you are full-time faculty? Yeah, I find it really hard as an adjunct. I have enough time. I'm spending 30 hours a week responding to emails and phone calls and grading papers. I love this group and I find a lot of great ideas, but to add four or five new things, like all these docs, students are having trouble just locating pronto. So I don't know. I mean, that's great. And I hate to like be that negative person. That's not my intent at all. I love what you do and I take a lot of it. It's great. I'm just also sitting here with sort of a panic. It's Friday. I'm not getting paid, which I volunteer to come here, right? But I spend a good 20 hours, 30 hours a week responding to my 9 hours of paid class.
Yeah.
At Mesa. And that's disheartening, you know.
I so hear that. Yeah. And I'm so impressed that you are here also and taking the time, even though you aren't paid for it. You know, one thing that I feel like is true, Espen, and I've talked to some of my adjunct colleagues about it, and I think it's been their experience too, is that with all these tools and things, there's lots of wonderful things you can do, but just like good teaching is going to come through no matter how you do it, right? So if you can't integrate every single tool, you're still a good teacher and your heart's in the right place. And so you're going to find ways to do it without like investing time in all of these different things. I don't know. Does that feel right to you or feel true?
Yeah, and again, I'm sorry. I want to be grateful. I am super grateful for all of you. I mean, Katie's been amazing over the years and Peg has been so helpful and all of you. So please try and take this in the tone that it's meant, which is just that I want to do more, but it's a bit
limited. Yeah.
So. No, that's actually something I actually like will preach over and over. And you guys know that from me is like, I've always believed that simple can be way effective. And so like, you know, I often get overwhelmed too. And I think it's important to remember that, yeah, you have the solid teaching and remember that is the point and all these extra tools and to make it look better and bigger. I've always thought it's hard because that feels like what you should do, but that comes when you have the time and it's not going to make or break the course. Like what's going to make and break the course is what you already have, what you're already doing. Right. And so feel comfortable that you're doing good and keep with that. And you can start adding these little things slowly. I try to like limit myself, add like one thing a semester. That's it. Like try not to add too many things or, you know, feel like you should be adding too many things.
Yeah, totally. And it's also like Espen said, it is overwhelming for the students too, if we're throwing a ton of tools at them all at once. So it isn't even just us. And Espen, I know how big your classes are too. So you're like putting in so much time just with the basic email answering, I'm sure.